Okay, thank you so much. Today I would like to talk on impact of microbial studies on the human society and its environment. Actually, I'm now working in Saudi Arabia and Japan both. Therefore, I made a frequent trip between Japan and Saudi Arabia. Could you give me a slide? Okay, already we are talking about the genome. As you may know, genome is a kind of a united between two terms, the gene and the chromosome, which was coined by German geneticist Hans Winkler in 1920. The later on, there is some modification including a functional context to the genome, which was made by Japanese geneticist Hitoshi Kihara in 1930. And as you know, that the human genome has been sequenced the year of 2000, and 16 years to sequence one single human genome, spending more than $600 million at least. But nowadays, even a single molecule sequencing can be done. And amazingly, this is called nanopore technology, which is just USB type. Then you can give it just drops of not DNA isolation, just like a rough samples, then it takes only 2.5 hours to sequence human genome, and the cost would be maybe $500, and the electricity power is a PC. Therefore, if you have 2,000 of those USB sequencer, then immediately within 2.5 hours, you get the 20,000 human genome. That's a revolutionary changing. And also, because of this kind of large-scale analysis, more exactly speaking, without any working hypothesis, first, we like to generate the data. And of course, there are criticism against this move. However, it is important for genome, we call genomics. Then messenger RNAs, we call transcriptomics. And RNAs, ribonomics, proteomics, and localizomics. So everything is called omics. And this is a very important paradigm. Of course, one of Nobel laureates, Sidonie Brenner, criticized against this approach, saying that low input, high throughput, no output. So which means, without considering anything, just high throughput, then obtaining a non-intellectual outcome. However, the situation is changing because of information science. In particular, 8 years ago, I made a kind of opinion article co-authored with American European colleagues saying that the big data would be a big issue in life science. Actually, the time has come. Really, we are suffering from big data. And today, I would like to talk on marine metagenomics. And first, I would like to explain what metagenomics is. When you take a seawater sample, then usually you like to see it under microscope, usual microscope. Then you might be excited to see animal planktons, plant planktons when you are young, but you can never see bacteria. And there are some archaea, which is a little bit different bacteria. Then you want to try to culture from seawater sample. Certainly you can check it bacteria. However, if the bacteria is unculturable, this work doesn't work. And we know that the substantial portion of marine bacteria are unculturable. So what we do? And what we do is metagenomics, which means by taking seawater sample, then immediately we sequence fragments of DNAs, whatever they are. We never know they are. We just sequence it. Then we obtain genomic fragments, a lot of genomic fragments. Then checking with database, and you know what kind of species, genus, phylum, whatever. And also we can know kind of a genes and inferring function from previously known genes. And this is called metagenome or metagenomics, because not single species genome sequencing, but more large number of unknown genomic fragment sequencing. So marine metagenomics is from seawater samples directly to DNA sequencing. This approach is called marine metagenomics. And it is quite a good opportunity, at least for myself, to make comparison between sea around Japan Island and also the Red Sea near between Arabian Peninsula and African continent. Why is it so? And here is Saudi Arabia, then those rectangular sea is called Red Sea. And the Red Sea is known to be very hot. Maybe in the summer, surface of seawater easily more than 30 or 35 centigrade degree. Then even 2,500 meters deep, so deep seawater, still the temperature is 22, 25 centigrade. It's so warm. And it's very beautiful, such a tremendously transparent. This is because oligotrophic, which means not much nutrition. Therefore, in particular, plant plankton cannot grow. That's why it's so transparent. However, salinity is so high, maybe 10 times larger than other sea. Also in a Red Sea, it is known that there are 11 major brine pool. Brine pool is like a lake in the deep sea. Lake is not freshwater lake. It's a high concentration of salinity lake. And what I'm saying that the Red Sea can be a kind of a model for the sea after global warming. Of course, it may not be so, but it should be close, which is quite different from the other sea regions. Therefore, if that is the case, how microbial community are different between Red Sea, probably like a kind of a model, possibly, of a global warming effect and ordinary sea. So first, I would like to talk on the sea around Japan. As you see, this is the Japan island, Honshu, Hokkaido. And those yellow and the red and the green, these are kind of a density of chlorophyll, which are observed from satellite infrared observation, And red and yellow means so much chlorophyll, which means a lot of plant planktons, and maybe having plant plankton, animal plankton eating plant plankton maybe a lot. Then small fish will be a lot. Eventually, the larger fish which are eating the smaller fish will be a lot. So it's a very nice fishery place. And therefore, this would be very interesting to see how microbial community is. In particular, we are interested in Sendai Bay, just in the northern part of Japan. As you remember, this region was hit by big earthquake. Afterwards, it was kind of a Fukushima Daiichi nuclear plant. Of course, radiation problem has been studied by the other group. We are not doing so. But we are more interested in microbial community in the sea. So this is a Sendai Bay. We had like more than 10 sampling stations. And like CO5, C12, it's a kind of representative sampling point. Of course, like Dr. Craig Benter used to have marine metagenomics in a Galaxo Sea in one point. But here we like to do marine metagenomics determining or setting up particular site. Then over time, we like to measure or observe how microbial communities are changing over the time. Of course, we like to know that how those changed after earthquake. Unfortunately, we don't have any data before earthquake. However, fortunately, we have samples of Hokkaido region, which are supposedly not much affected by earthquake. Therefore, we can compare between Sendai Bay and those regions. So there are twofold meaning. One is, what is the time change situation of microbial community in a Sendai Bay? And the other is, what is earthquake effect? Okay, this is just like a research boat which was owned by Fishery Research Agency of Japanese government. We have a project, almost a 5 years project. Then behind myself, there is a cylinder. And usually, each cylinder has three chambers. And upper and the lower, there is a faucet. If you make it down up to, say, 30 meters deep, then the bottom chamber will be open, then seawater comes in, then close it. Then we taking it up to 20 meters deep, then second chamber will be open, then close it, then as the same way to 10 meters deep. In this way, we can take a seawater different depth of the sea regions. And sometimes we do filtering on the board because we like to get fresh DNA as much as possible. Of course, compared with RNA, DNA is more stable, but this we do. So anyway, our future characteristics of project future is we do time series sampling. And here is kind of data. We have three filters, 10 microns, 2 microns, and 0.2 microns, and surely we have DNAs, a lot of DNAs. Before we start this project, some people said, Takashi, okay, even 10 meters different point, seawater always changing, therefore you may not get any consistent result. Some people said that maybe seawater environment is quite stable. Therefore, you may not have any changes. So anyway, whatever it is, we conducted metagenomics. And we have total samples, including time and locations, 573 samples, time and locations. Then we sequenced 330 billion nucleotides. And right now, I believe we have more than 500 billion nucleotides. So huge data. We have already a database which has not been public yet. But for a given time and location, immediately we can show from the database what kind of bacterial species are there. This is a kind of a pie chart of microbial community composition. And in the case of Sendai Bay, as you see, particular species of bacteria is quite dominant, then second, third. And when we checked comparison between Sendai Bay and off Hokkaido the sea, interestingly, the community composition was not so much different. Therefore, certainly after earthquake, Sendai Bay microbial community must have drastically changed. But amazingly, maybe within a year, it has resumed. So tremendous, I would say, robustness of microbial community can be speculated from this. And moreover, we can see spatial variation. For example, so this is a kind of Sendai Bay and the transection of the sea. Like here is a depth, and this is a left side is shallow, and the right side is quite deep, and there are data point. So in this way, so we are taking seawater those point over the time. Then these are, I didn't specify the name of bacteria. However, the yellow color, red color, and the blue color, it's almost you know, different phylum of a bacteria. And from here, you can see some grouping can be seen. And this is a chlorophyll alpha chart of the transection features of the bay. Then, apparently, microbial community has a tremendous separation of niche, depending on regions over the bay. And sorry, this is actually April of 2012, but then this is December. The winter, a little bit the temperature is lower, and the chlorophyll is much less. But still, like a microbial community can be seen clearly having their own ecological niche. And more interestingly, we can see x-axis shows kind of a seasons, spring, summer, autumn, and winter. Since we have 3 years sampling record, therefore we know reproducibility of this kind of changes. Then certainly we can follow what kind of changes can be seen. Then amazingly, all over 3 years, clearly it shows the different community depending on January, April, August, and November, which means overall, I think microbial community is affected by seasonal change. Therefore, not micro environment, much more global environment. Of course, not so so large, I would say regional environment. Therefore, microbial community, the sea around Japan Island, it looks that it shows clear feature of four seasonal changes. And so this is the Japanese, then we developed so-called digital DNA chip. All markers of sampling point can be placed in a virtual chip. This is a not, a physical chip. In a computer, in a memory, we can place those fragment of DNA, genomic fragment for given time, given C region. Then when you have samples and obviously DNA sequence data, then you check with this chip. Then apparently, particular region, particular time, it has a particular pattern. So this chip would give you kind of identification of seawater samples. Just like a wine sommelier, if you give a glass of seawater, and this chip would give you, okay, this is in the ocean, maybe August, like this kind of things. So from this, I think this digital DNA chip can be utilized for kind of checking of seawater microbial community, and particularly when you are interested in a climate change or global warming. Moreover, we developed automatic sampling apparatus. Actually, you don't have to take the ship. Those machines can immediately get seawater for a given position, locations. And if we can utilize USB chip and with computer through solar energy, and this can monitor anytime, any location over the seawater regions. Of course, there are some typhoon, others, but anyway, essentially, it can be done. So this is a kind of a global warming, a global monitoring system of seawater microbial community can be done. Okay, then let us go to the Red Sea. And the Red Sea here, the near the city called Jeddah, and around less than 10 kilometers away, we have a sampling point. Here we had a 1 meter, 10 meter, 20 meter, and every month we had one. Sorry. Then in this case, we use a smaller boat, but anyway. And again, we have already 500 billion nucleotides has been sequenced. So we are at a very good position to make a comparison between the sea around Japan Island and the Red Sea, which can be a model of global warming. Then I think we found 75% of bacteria and 15% of viruses, and the others are unknown. Then what we obtained, this is a kind of a composition. I didn't show the detailed analysis, but what we can see is, in a Red Sea, not much change, not much seasonal changes. Of course, in Saudi Arabia, there is a hot summer, and a reasonably nice winter. Therefore, sometimes we see like two seasons, 1.5 seasons, but we cannot reproduce it. But essentially, it looks no much seasonal changes. Therefore, it can be kind of an outcome after global warming, the bacterial community in the sea, it may cause kind of a breakdown of a seasonal change. Of course, it depends on the regions. And however, you know, let's see, has a tremendously interesting features of microbes, just like we discussed the patent. And from seawater, we can isolate the genes, and we see what kind of, say, enzymatic activities are. If we can see novel enzymatic activity, which can be very useful, like a lipase for a detergent, cellulase for a bioenergy. And this is a really a nice genetic resources. And it was said, science is gamble, then you need to win. Then the point is how to win. One of approach is we do win until we continue to until win. So anyway, we do a praying survey and the enzymatic activities. We are getting very interesting result. Moreover, we are conducting microfluidics, nanodroplet selection, sorry. And like we designed a droplet in which single E. coli cell, which has been you know, genetically modified, say insertion of particular segment, then we can make a selection which can have activity against for a given substrate or not. So just I should be. Could you start the movie? Sorry, could you start the movie? Okay, yeah. So this is a droplet, and in the small spot, this is E. coli, which has a, let's see, a gene fragment. So in this way, the 100,000 of fragment can be screen in this way. So we are quite successful doing so. Also by utilizing CRISPR-Cas9 system, the function can be validated, say, using Hydra. Okay. So I'm going to, then conclusion is, first, comparing between Sea of Japan and Red Sea, apparently seasonal change would be a key, particularly when you are interested in global warming. Okay. And I would like to say that the fourth paradigm, which was proposed by Gray, Jim Gray, which is a database expert, and he proposed that data-driven scientific discovery will be a fourth paradigm, and which is now not only information science, in life science is coming. So as I said, that we can see the vision, how we can establish or construct the automatic monitoring system like this, then eventually we'll see those microbial community can be overseen over the time or locations. So I would call genome information oriented society, and that can be, we can look at the how we utilize or how we see the genomic information from this point of view. Okay, so anyway, DNA should be used for world peace. And those are our collaborators' acknowledgement. Okay. Thank you so much.